The topic for today is traffic load consideration to different types of bridges. And I'm the speaker for today and little bit about myself. So my name is Vishal Prasad, and I have a master's degree in structural engineering with over 8 years experience in bridges, cut and cover tunnels, and track slab. Currently, I work in WSP in their bridges and structures team in Sydney. I have previously worked in Malaysia, India, and UK. Little bit about WSP. It is one of the world's leading engineering professional service consulting firms with over 50,000 employees globally and 5,000 plus in Australia, New Zealand region. So WSP offers a full suite of engineering, environmental, geotechnical, and other specialized design services, assisting both public and private clients to plan, develop, design, construct, operate, and maintain critical infrastructure projects. So today we'll be going through these topics. So I'll start with a bit of background on influence line analysis. Then we'll go on to moving load analysis. Then I'll take you through some verification studies. And finally, the main part of the presentation, which is the case studies. So I'll be demonstrating how to use moving load analysis in MIDAS on line beam models, grillage models, and also planar models. So before we get into the main slides, so I would like just like to make a quick announcement that today's presentation will be I'll be talking about the functions in MIDAS, moving load analysis functions, but the presentation will mainly be focused to Australian standards. So all your questions are welcome, but if you could restrict them to Australian codes, that will be great. Any questions not relating to moving load analysis or to other international codes, I might take them separately. So that's a request. And when you ask your question, I might all answer all the questions at the end. So if you could just code the case study number or the slide number, that will be great for me to answer. Secondly, the methods that I'll be using to demonstrate today is purely based on my personal preference. So you could have other ways or smarter ways to do something similar. So feel free to share your ideas. And lastly, the models that I'll be using today to demonstrate the functions are taken from actual projects, but they are modified for two reasons. First thing, for confidentiality. And secondly, the models are simplified just to demonstrate the moving load analysis features. So with those announcements, I'll just get going. So before we get into the details of moving load analysis, first let's understand what are loads. So loads are any external force or imposed deformation on a structure. It could be permanent in nature, such as dead loads or superimposed dead loads, or they could be transient, such as thermal, wind, or live loads. They could be both static or dynamic in nature. Live loads are typically dynamic, and they are mainly due to traffic, such as vehicles, locomotives, rolling stock, pedestrian, etc. These loads have both a vertical and a horizontal component. And in today's webinar, I'll mainly be discussing on the vertical component. As I told you, live loads are dynamic in nature, but they are analyzed as a static load with an additional dynamic amplification factor to account for the dynamic effects. Live loads, unlike the permanent loads, they don't have a fixed positions, so they can be placed at multiple possible positions as the traffic traverses across the bridge. So hence we need a moving load analysis, which is typically a static analysis. And what it does is it basically finds the worst load effects out of various possible load positions along the bridge. And this is done based on the concept of influence line and or influence surface. So let's see what is an influence line. So an influence line represents the variation of either the reaction, shear, moment, or deflection at a specific point in a member as a unit concentrated force moves over that member. And once the influence line is drawn, the location of live load which will cause the greatest influence on the structure can be found easily. So for example, if you see here in the top left, this is an influence line diagram for a two-span continuous bridge. So if you need to obtain a maximum flexure at say point A, which is at the mid span of span one, then you should be loading only that portion of the span which is under positive influence. So in this case, it will be this triangular part, which is over span one. If you load on span two, this will have a relieving effect for maximum positive or sagging moment at A. So you should only be loading the spans which are under the positive influence. So that's how the concept of influence line works. And similarly, influence line can be drawn on a other continuous bridges, such as this is a four span continuous bridge, and this is how the influence line looks for a four span bridge. So just to elaborate on the influence line concept, so I've taken two cases. In the first case, it's a five span continuous bridge and I've loaded all the spans equally. And in the second case, it's the same five span continuous bridge, but I have loaded alternate spans. And as many engineers might think that more the load, more will be the flexure or shear, but that's not the case. So if you see in the first figure, although all spans are loaded and the load is the total load is much higher, the moment is 157. Whereas in the second case, only alternate spans are loaded and you can see the moment is much higher. So this loading pattern is derived based on the concept of influence lines. And that's why influence lines are so important, that it tells you where to load to get the maximum effects. So on the same lines of influence line analysis, you can build up an influence surface as well. So it looks very similar to influence lines, just that it is in on a surface, and it will give you both longitudinal and transverse distribution. So influence surface is mainly used for plate type elements, whereas influence line is for beam elements. Just to put a note here, when you're doing a model in MIDAS, you can't use influence line and influence surface analysis together in one analysis. So if you have defined influence line, you cannot define an influence surface in the same model. Now looking at how moving load analysis works in MIDAS. So it represents a series of analysis for all loading conditions created along the entire moving load path to find the maximum and minimum values which are used as a result of the moving load case. So the procedure is something like that. So you first select the moving load code, then you define traffic lanes, then you define vehicles, then you set up the moving load case. And when you click run, the software will first do an influence line analysis, and then the moving load results will be generated based on the influence line results. So going into each of the tabs a bit in detail. So first, when you have to select the design code, MIDAS offers a variety of, it covers most of the international codes, including Australia. And after defining the code, you have to define, after selecting the code, you have to define the traffic line lanes. So traffic lanes can be defined in two ways. So this is the first method wherein you define individual traffic lanes. And when defining the traffic lanes, this is done by referencing to a reference element. So you can position the traffic lane at an eccentricity to the reference element, but how the load is to be distributed is determined by this window here. So vehicular load distribution. So if you select lane element, then even though the traffic lane, if it is at an eccentricity, it will only be applied, the loads only will be applied on the reference element. So it will have a vertical component plus a moment. But if you select cross beam, the loads will actually be applied at that particular position, and it will be distributed through the cross beams and to all the longitudinal girders. So for a grillage analysis, cross beam is generally recommended. And another feature this MIDAS gives you in traffic line lanes is the transverse lane optimization. So if you take the transverse lane optimization, the software will float the vehicles within the available width. So usually it creates three positions. One is aligned towards the left, the second one is right, and then lastly at the center. So another way where you can define traffic lanes, or in this case the whole carriageway. So when you use moving load optimization, you can you just need to define the total carriageway width and specify some lane width parameters, and so the software will automatically determine the number of lanes, and also it will place the lanes automatically depending on what output is required. So this is a very good feature where you don't have to define the individual lanes, but just you need to define the whole carriageway. After you have defined the traffic lanes, Now you have to select the vehicular load. So the software already has some predefined loads. So for Australian standards, currently we have road and pedestrian vehicles defined or loads defined. The rail loads will shortly be released in the month of June. That's what I've been told. So, but currently, if you want to define some load which is not there in the predefined library, you can define your own loads as well, and that's possible by using user-defined loads. So there are three ways you can define. It can be either a truck lane load, and these are typically used to define loads such as T44 or L44, and then you can define train loads, permit truck, and permit truck is mainly used to define HLP, heavy load platform kind of loads. So I'm taking these vehicle names, and they are particularly for Australian codes. So apologies if someone is not able to follow, but as I told you, today's presentation is focused to Australian standards only. After you have defined the vehicles, you need to create a moving load case. So to create a moving load case, the software gives you a variety of options. Either it can be for general purpose, for traffic line lanes, it could be for permit vehicles. You can have moving load optimization or for fatigue. And the next tab here is the accompanying lane factor. So as some of you would know, like when you have multiple lane loaded, then you can give an accompanying lane factor, and that is done here. So these are the default values that Midas has already taken. This is based on AS5100, but if you want, these factors can be changed depending on the situation. The last feature here in moving load case is the loading effect. This is a very great feature, I would say, because this allows you to combine two different vehicles or vehicle class together in one moving load case. So if you have a case where you have a HLP running over two lanes and then M1600 over the remaining lanes, so that all can be done in one load case rather to create a individual load case and then creating combinations. After you have set up the moving load case, before you click run or analyze, it's very, very important, and I recommend all the engineers to go to this tab. This is available in the analysis window, and it says moving load analysis control data. So this has a variety of parameters that you can define. So what this does is basically it helps you to control the runtime. So for example, if you have a big bridge and with thousands of elements, and you are just interested to know the results for a particular girder, so you can create a group of only that girder and then select what result is required. So if you just need the force and moments, you just tick force and moments and leave the other boxes empty. So what this will do is the software will only run the influence line and moving load analysis for that particular group of elements, and this will save a lot of runtime. So it's highly recommended. And there are other parameters also that you can modify to reduce the runtime. So after analysis, you can view the results in variety of formats. So Midas gives you influence line surfaces. It shows you moving load tracer. So moving load tracer is basically the software will actually show the wheel positions for a maximum value at a particular element. And then the results can be viewed in the form of table diagrams or contours. So this is the form of result table that Midas produces. The good part is it's very nicely put up in rows and columns, and it can be easily exported or extracted to Excel sheet, which is quite good. And usually the result table is sorted by highest values, but if you're interested to know the corresponding values for some max value item, say if you are interested to know the corresponding shear for a maximum moment at a particular point, then you can view that by view by max value item, and that can be obtained by right clicking on the result table, and then you select view by max value item. On the same concept, you can also view concurrent reaction. So if you have say five bearings, and if you need the concurrent reactions for the case where you have maximum reaction at a particular bearing, so this becomes quite useful, concurrent reaction. So these are some of the results that you can view. Going on to next, this is a small verification study that I did. So the only reason of putting this slide together is just to emphasize that you should always do some kind of a verification when you're doing any analysis model using any software, not just Midas. So You should not blindly trust the software. So you should have some kind of verification. It could be hand calculations, or you can verify it through some other software. So I recommend that you use some base model and then maybe run the model with only dead load or some simple point loads. And then you can check the total reaction or the force, deflection, whatever is possible. And so for this case, today's presentation for moving load analysis, so I did a small verification wherein I compared the flexure and shear for Australian moving load cases, and I compared the results with the values given in back of the code. So this is Appendix C in AS5100 Part 2. And it gives you all the it gives you flexure and shear values for SM1600 and 300 LA load, and depending on the span length, you can compare the shear and flexure values in the model. So I built a line beam model, a 2D line beam model, and I ran a single lane of these loads, and then I compared the flexure and shear. So this is the results I obtained. So as you can see, the error is quite low. It's almost 0.5% or less than 0.5% when the span increases. So based on this small verification study, I feel MIDAS gives you quite good results, and it is in coordinates with the Australian standard values. So now I'll go to the case studies. So I've divided the case studies into three parts. The first group is line beam models. So these are typically used for box girders, steel tubs, or any other type of box structures. And then these are mainly used to calculate the longitudinal effects, and they can also be used as a transverse analysis in the form of a 2D line beam model. The next group is grillage models. So these are basically it is used to calculate the effects for multi-girder tech or multi-cell box cutter, and you can get both longitudinal and transverse effects. And the last group of models is the planar models, or plate or shell model. And these are mainly used where a grillage is built with a deck model as plate and the girders model as beam elements. Or you can use it for solid slabs or plate girders. And this will also give you both longitudinal and transverse effects. So moving on to the first group of case studies. I just want to announce that in each of the case study, I have picked up some feature for demonstration. So I won't be demonstrating all the features in each case study, but I will be choosing one particular feature, and I'll be demonstrating through a variety of case studies. So the first case study is of a rail seat load. So in this model, I was mainly interested to calculate the maximum reaction at a sleeper or a rail pad under the rail. So this is a 2D line beam model, and each of the node represents a sleeper or a rail pad. So I have run a rail load, a 200 LA load, and I'll be showing you how to establish the traffic line lanes in a 2D model. So because this is a straight line model, I could use the two-point method to define the traffic lanes. So all the elements in this model are on the straight line from point one to point two, and hence you can easily use a two-point method to define the traffic lanes. Because it's a 2D model, you should be using lane element for vehicular load distribution because there are no cross beams. I'll explain when to use cross beams later. Next, to define the loads, because it is a rail load, so currently MIDAS doesn't has predefined rail loads for Australian standards. So I had to use truck lane user-defined vehicular load, and with the axle loads and the axle spacing, it's very easy to input here in this window, and that's how you generate user-defined vehicles. After defining the vehicle, you need to define the moving load case. So because it's a single lane or a single track with a single vehicle, it's very easy. So you select the vehicle and the corresponding track, and then you create the moving load case. The factor here I've put under scale 1.5 is mainly to account for dynamic amplification factor. This is just a personal preference, so you may put the dynamic amplification factor later while creating load combinations or even externally, say in an Excel sheet. So this scale factor can be used for a variety of reasons. It could be a load combination factor or some other factor or dynamic factor. So yeah, and then once you click analyze, Midas will generate the results. So this is one of the results. So you can go to results moving load tracer. And what moving load tracer does is it will show you the exact wheel positions for maximum value at a particular node. So I was interested in maximum reaction at node 23, which is here in the red circle zone. And this is the load position that Midas will give you. And the good part of this feature is you can also write that particular load to a static load case. So what this does is out of the various load positions that Midas has generated, if you're only interested to know the effects due to a particular load position, you can extract that load position into a separate static load case, and then you need to rerun the model to get the to obtain the results for that particular load case. And the other forms of results are reaction table. So these are available here in the results table. There's a lot of items that can be obtained in tabular format. Another thing I want to emphasize here is you can create a concurrent reaction group. So as you saw previously in the model, so there were a lot of nodes. So if I'm interested to see the corresponding reaction at adjacent nodes to say node 23, then I can create a concurrent reaction group for those nodes, and then that can be viewed in the concurrent reaction table. So the first table will give you only the greatest values, whereas the concurrent table will give you the concurrent values corresponding to a particular max value at a node. So that was the first case. The second case is of a pedestrian bridge. This is a four-span continuous bridge. It is curved in profile. So through this example, I'll show you how to define curved traffic lane and how to use pedestrian node. So because it's a curved bridge, you can't use a two-point method to define traffic line lanes. The reason being, when you draw a line from say first point to the last point, then there are no elements found along that line, and hence Midas will give you an error, no beam element online. And hence in such situations, either you can use selection by number or you can use picking. So in this case, I've used selection by number. So to do that, you just select all the elements on the traffic line lane and then select that elements from here and then put it here in this tab. So this is how you define traffic line lanes for curved bridges. After you have defined the traffic lane, I use the predefined pedestrian load function available in Midas. So it's the good part of this function is Midas has already predefined parameters, and this basically simulates the graph here, which is given in AS5100. So the pedestrian load intensity is actually dependent on the loaded area, and Midas, based on these parameters, already automatically determines the pedestrian load intensity. So the users need not worry about the intensity. So to just give you an example, if there is a four span bridge, and in one load case, if the load is only on first two spans, then the load intensity will be calculated for that two span loading. And in another case, if all spans are loaded, say four spans, then the load intensity would be different for that four span loaded case. So in this case, the software automatically works out the intensity, and that's quite a good feature because the user need not assign different intensity for different loading patterns. So some of the results, you can obtain a moving load tracer for say sagging, shear, or hogging. So in addition to the load positions, Midas also gives you the influence line diagram. So here where my mouse cursor is. So this is there in the background, and it gives you the influence line for similar like sagging, shear, or hogging, or any other parameter. It can give you influence lines for deflections and reactions as well. So these are some of the results. Moving on to the next case study, this is about a road bridge. It's a two-span continuous bridge, and this is an old bridge, so I wanted to do a structural assessment for the vehicles T44 and L44. So these vehicles are again not predefined in Midas currently. So to do that, I used a user-defined function. So using truck lane, I defined T44 and L44 loads. And then to define the moving load case, this time I used moving load optimization. So some may think that moving load optimization is only used for grillage, but no, you can also use it for a 2D line beam model. So the only advantage of moving load optimization is that you just specify the carriageway width and the number of traffic lanes and the position will automatically be determined by the software. And of course, you need to put other parameters such as lane width, wheel spacing, margin based on the wheel configuration, the vehicle configuration. So after using after defining the carriageway, you can set up the moving load case by clicking this tab here, moving load optimization, because you wish to use the optimizer, and then you select the carriageway and then the vehicles, and that's how you create the moving load case. So some of the results, so this is maximum flexure value at midspan for T44, and this is for L44 load case. So that was about the case studies for line beam models. Next, I'll be taking you through the grillage model case studies. So the first model is a straight bridge. This is a very simple example, and it's a one span simply supported bridge using Super T plus composite deck. And I'll be showing how to define traffic lane for grillage, and I'll also be showing you how to combine different vehicles. So I've used moving load optimization for vehicles or for combining vehicles which have similar wheel configuration. So if all the vehicles in a load group in a vehicle class have same wheel spacing and also same traffic lane width, then you can use moving load optimizer to create the carriageway or the traffic line lanes. But if you have to combine two vehicles which have different wheel spacing, and in this case, so this is a case where you have HLP vehicle plus M1600. So HLP occupies two traffic lanes. So in this case, the traffic lane widths are not same for both the vehicles. So hence, you can't use moving load optimizer. And the preferred way is to use traffic line lane. And in this way, you can define separate lanes for separate vehicles and then make the combination. So when you make the combination, so for combining vehicles with similar lane widths, you can use the optimizer, similar to the way I've explained you previously. And then you can put all the vehicles in a particular vehicle class. So for example, SM1600 represents the vehicles W80, A160, and other vehicles. So you need not create a separate load case for each of these vehicles. You can put all the vehicles here and Midas will calculate the worst effects. Similarly, when you have to combine the HLP with M1600, you use the normal way to form the moving load case. And in this case, you have to select the corresponding traffic lanes defined for the particular vehicles. So I defined a separate lane for HLP. And when I select the HLP, I should be careful that I should only use that lane, which is corresponding to a two lane width lanes. And then for M1600, you use the M1600 lane. And I've used a factor of 0.5 in the scale. This is because when you combine HLP with M1600, the code says that you need to consider only 50% of the M1600 component. So visually, this is how the results will look if you use independent or combined. It's very straightforward. If you use independent, only one particular vehicle will be put, whereas if you use combined, Midas will consider both the vehicle class loaded together. Next example is of a skew bridge. So I'll be demonstrating how to define traffic lanes for skew bridges. So the skew is 30 degrees here in this bridge. So to define the traffic lane, it is very important that you go into this in this tab where you have to specify the skew. So if you specify the right skew, the traffic lanes will be nicely spread over the whole deck. And this skew is usually the skew of the deck. And in case if you don't put the right skew, and say if you put it zero, the lanes will be defined perpendicular to the reference element, and there will be a portion of the deck which will be empty or that will be left unloaded. So to get the right loading conditions, you should be putting the right skew here. In this case, I also want to demonstrate another thing. The carriageway width in this case was 9 meters, and with individual traffic lanes width being 3.2 meters, you can only accommodate two lanes. And when you have two lanes, you can have multiple traffic lane configurations. So in one case, you can have both the lanes aligned towards the left curb, or in the other case, it can be aligned to the right curb. So in this scenario, you need not create multiple load cases for different traffic lane configurations. You can combine the different traffic configurations again in one load case. But this time, instead of selecting combined, you should be selecting independent, because all those traffic lane configurations are independent. So if you click combined, it will create wrong results because the traffic lanes could be overlapped as well. So this is how you combine various traffic lane configurations. So seeing some of the results, you can obtain the member forces in the form of a tabular format. So you can go to results and then result tables. So the first table that usually MIDAS gives you is the table with the greatest values. But if you want the corresponding forces for a max value item, you can go to max value item, and then you can obtain different tables for different max value items. So for example, the second table is a max value item for moment. So in this case, the column here under moment will give you the maximum moments, and the other columns will give you the corresponding, say, shear, torsion, or whatever you need. So you can have multiple tables sorted by different max value items. So the last table is max value item by shear. The next example is of a rail plus road bridge. So in this case, you have a combination of rail plus road load. So I'll be showing you how to combine such loads, and also how to use traffic transverse lane optimization. So while defining traffic lanes, so I couldn't use moving load optimizer because they are different loads, different vehicles. So I had to use traffic line lanes. So I defined a lane for track and another lane for the road. So when defining the traffic lane for the road, this time I used transverse lane optimization, and the reason being because the available carriageway width was more than the design lane width. So this would mean that the traffic lane could be positioned in multiple configurations. And to avoid defining multiple configurations, you can just click this box here, transverse lane optimization, and then the software will float the vehicle transversely in the allowable width. So this is quite handy, especially when you have the carriageway width more than the design lane width. Just to highlight here, I know it's very obvious, but you should not be selecting transverse lane optimization for rail loads, because as you know, the track position is fixed and it will never be floated. So just to give you a reminder. So again, to combine the loads, you select combined, you select the rail load and the corresponding track, and then the road load and the corresponding carriageway, or sorry, the traffic lane. And then you just select combine. And in this case, I've used a scale factor of 1.5 for rail because to account for DLA. I've left the scale factor as 1 for M1600 because MIDAS automatically, not automatically, it already considers the dynamic amplification factor in while defining M1600. So that was about the rail plus road bridge. The next example is of a curved bridge. So this is a two-span continuous steel box girder bridge, and I'll show you how to define a reaction local and how to use moving load optimization. So for a curved bridge, you can assign local access to your supports or the bearings. So the bearings could either be aligned tangential to the curve, or it could be aligned towards the point of fixity. So this can be done by going into boundary, and then you go to the node local axis, and then you can assign different local axis for each bearing. So once the local axis is defined, then there are two possible options to obtain the results. So you can obtain the reactions, say in the global direction, or you can also obtain the reaction in the local direction. So these are the two outputs that MIDAS gives you. And as I was also mentioning, I'll also be explaining how to use moving load optimization in a bit more detail here in this case. So in this example, because it was a curved bridge and I wanted to ensure all the transverse lane positions are considered, so I used moving load optimization, and this time I put a very low value of offset from center line. So what the software does is the first position that it will place the vehicles would be along the center line of the carriageway, and based on the offset, it will keep offsetting the vehicles until it reaches the edge of the carriageway. So if you put a very low value, you will be rest assured that all the possible lanes are kind of covered. But if you put a very low value, then this will also increase the runtime. So one should be judicious while selecting this parameter here. So select, say, 0.5 to 1 meter is usually recommended for a glitch type of analysis. And when you use the moving load optimizer, this is how the results look. So if you need, so in the first figure, I wanted to see the maximum hogging moment for the left girder. And you see the loads are aligned towards the left. And in the second figure, I wanted the maximum values for the right girder. And you see the loads are automatically shifted to the right. So in this way, you don't have to manually create multiple traffic lane configurations. The software automatically does that for you when you use moving load optimizer. The next example is of a six span continuous bridge. So this is this bridge I've just taken to demonstrate how to use how to define traffic lanes for such complicated geometry. So in this case, the red portion of the bridge is an existing bridge and the blue portion is a new bridge, which is going to be connected to the existing bridge. So in such situations wherein you have merging traffic or diverging traffic, you can have the lane widths which could be varying. Or in other instance, when you define the traffic line lanes, you have to put a skew value. But in this case, you see the skew is different on the right, and as the vehicle moves, the skew changes. So in such scenarios, you'll have to use a bit of judgment and also do some you'll have to define some load cases manually. So one way is you just consider various possible traffic lane configurations and then make a combination. So in this case, I created several combinations to ensure that I have considered all the possible load positions. So in this case, the skew is aligned to this edge. In the second case, the skew is aligned to the left edge, and then I created other traffic lane configurations. So in such complicated geometries, there is no set way to do it, but you'll have to make a bit of judgment and create line lanes just to ensure all the possible positions are covered. That was the end of Grillage models case studies. Now moving on to the case studies for planar models. So the first example is this example is very same to the example I used for the Grillage models. It's a simple single span simply supported bridge. The only difference being, in this case, I have modeled the girders as frame or beam elements, whereas I have modeled the deck as plate elements. So this kind of modeling is usually not recommended for straight bridges. You should be modeling the deck as plate element for maybe skewed or curved bridges. But I have used this example just for demonstration. So when you have the deck model as plate elements, you can use the traffic surface lanes, which is very similar to traffic line lanes, and it is located next to it in the moving load analysis window. The functions are very similar, but you can expect to get more accurate results when you use traffic surface lanes. But it also depends on the surface, the element size and also the bridge geometry. So, and also when you use traffic surface lanes, you could end up having a longer runtime. So it depends on case to case. And to define the traffic surface lanes, it is done very similar to traffic line lanes. So in this case, you need to, the only difference being that there's no vehicular load distribution here in this case, as in when we use traffic line lanes, there was an option to select cross beam or a lane element. So in this case, because it's a surface, it will consider both longitudinal and transverse distribution. So you can define individual surface lanes, or you can also similarly define moving load optimization like you do for traffic line lanes. Again, creating moving load case is done similarly as you would do for traffic line lanes. And finally, the results would look like that. So when you use an influence surface, you will not be able to see influence lines, as MIDAS only allows either influence lane or influence surface in one analysis. So in this case, because I selected influence surfaces, so this is the kind of influence surface you would get for maximum bending at a point which is almost at the mid span. And then the moving load tracer looks very similar. So it will show you where the wheels are positioned for maximum moment at that particular element. The next case study is about a culvert. So in the previous example, that model was like a hybrid wherein the beams were modeled as frame elements and the plate and the deck as plate elements. But in this case, because the culvert is having a uniform cross section, so all the elements are modeled as plate elements. So again, traffic surface lanes can be used for such models where you have plate elements only. And I'll be showing you how to use permit vehicles through this example. And sorry, this example is for a load rating. So I had to define several loads which were specific to a particular state, which are of course not available in MIDAS. So I used permit vehicle function to define those specific vehicles. So to define, to run the permit vehicles, you need to set up a reference lane. And this can be done by using a traffic surface lane. You just define some width and some wheel spacing. Just to highlight here that the wheel spacing that you enter here for permit vehicles is actually not relevant, because the wheel spacing that you actually put in the permit vehicle window will be used, and not this wheel spacing that you put used for defining traffic surface lanes. And when you have to define traffic lanes for say T44 vehicles, you could use moving load optimizer. So how to define the permit vehicles? So you can go to the user defined vehicular load and select permit. And I would say permit vehicle function, permit truck function is the most versatile function that MIDAS offers. So it can, using this function, you can create multiple axles with varying wheel spacing. So for example, the first axle could have just two wheels, and the next axle could have four, and the rest axles could have eight wheels, and all the wheel spacings could be different. So this is all possible by using the permit truck, and it allows you to create most of the vehicle configurations using this function. So how to create moving load case? So for permit vehicle, the window looks slightly different than the normal moving load case definition. So when you have to define the load case for permit vehicle, basically you select this tick box, and then this window is generated. So in this case, you select the permit vehicle and the corresponding reference lane, and then you have to enter the eccentricity. So eccentricity is basically how eccentric the load has to be with reference to the center line of the lane. So usually in Australian standards, you may end up using one, minus one, or zero at times. So in this case, I've used zero. And to create a load case for T44 vehicles, you can use moving load optimizing, as have been demonstrating previously. So this is a small difference when you have to define permit vehicle as compared to the normal truck loads. And these are some of the results. So you can obtain a plate bending diagram for permit vehicle or T44 vehicles. So as the permit vehicle runs only on one lane and usually centrally to the carriageway, so you see high concentration of bending moment in the central zone. Whereas for a T44 load, because I use moving load optimizer and put maximum loaded lanes as three, so you see the bending is nicely spread, because it's three lane loaded. And these plate bending results are obtained through influence surface. So it is obtained based on the influence surface results. So an influence surface for bending about the longitudinal axis would look something like this. So this is a 3D rendered view of the influence surface. So that's all about my case studies for today. So I'll quickly summarize what we have learned today. So moving load analysis in MIDAS is based on influence lines or surface, and moving load analysis features include, so MIDAS gives you option to select various international codes, and it also gives you predefined vehicles and an option to define your user defined vehicles. You can define individual traffic line lanes. So while defining individual traffic line lanes, you can also use transverse option, which gives you an option to transversely float the vehicles within a lane. And if you don't want to define individual traffic lanes, you can also define the whole carriageway, and the software will automatically calculate the individual traffic lanes and its position when you select moving load optimization. So this is a very useful tool. And finally, to create the moving load case, Midas gives you a variety of options wherein you can combine several scenarios in one case, and you need not create multiple load cases. And before you click run, as I have been emphasizing previously, you must go to moving load analysis control, because this window will help you control what are the results that you want. So you can filter the results, and correspondingly, you can reduce the runtime. And finally, after you have analyzed the structure, Midas gives you a variety of result outputs. You can see the results in the form of diagrams, contours for force, displacement, stresses, reaction, etc. And the results can also be obtained in the form of result tables, and you can view concurrent or simultaneous forces and also concurrent reactions. And you can view the moving load tracer. So moving load tracer allows you to see exactly where the wheels are positioned for a maximum value at a particular element or a node. So this helps you to visually see the vehicle positions, and it also helps you to verify whether the loads are positioned correctly as you have expected. If it is not, then you should be going back to your model and see check your geometry or the boundary conditions or even the load application. So this is a useful tool. And finally, to conclude, I would say Midas offers a quite a user-friendly interface, and I would say it most of the post-processing can be done within the software, and you need not worry about extracting the results to an Excel file or design spreadsheets. So a lot of the functionality is available in the software itself. So overall, it's quite a user-friendly. It has a user-friendly interface. So that's about my presentation. I'll now take up some questions. So feel free to either put it in the chat box the question box, or depending on the availability of time, I might answer some of the questions. But if I don't answer, you can send your questions to Midas at info@midasit.com, or you can also email it to me.